The CBS Radio Mystery Theater presents... Come in. Welcome. I'm E.G. Marshall. Welcome to the fear you can hear. Welcome to the world of your own terrifying imagination. The art of the double cross, unfortunately, has become part of the fabric of our lives. In espionage, however, it is almost a lifestyle. In the world of spies, for the left hand ever to know what the right is doing is unthinkable. For the next hour, imagine that you are Larry Fielding, a 32-year-old newspaper man caught in a dizzying web of circumstances seemingly beyond his control.
Larry, please change your mind and come with me.
Not until you tell me who you are and why you sneaked into my hotel room.
You're a fool, Larry. You must know that the police are looking for you and they'll be here any minute.
Oh, well, you're here now. And I still want to know who you are.
If that's so important, my name is Carol Johnson. And when I tell you I know all about the murder of Dave Wilson, maybe you'll believe that I'm here to help you.
Our mystery drama, The Lady Was a Tiger, written especially for the Mystery Theater by Murray Burnett, stars William Redfield. It is sponsored in part by Anheuser-Busch Incorporated, brewers of Budweiser, and by the Kellogg Company, makers of Kellogg's Special K cereal. I'll be back shortly with Act One. Walking is great exercise, and with good weather can also be great fun. But not when you've just been fired by the editor of the newspaper for which you've worked happily for 5 years. Larry Fielding has been walking aimlessly for 2 hours, trying to figure out why Horace Finley, the editor and his boss, had refused to give him any reason for his dismissal. Tormented by his frustrating thoughts and tired, Larry sits down on a park bench to think. He is so deep in thought, he is unaware of three men who suddenly surround him. Larry has only to look at them to know that he is in trouble. He tries to get up, but is pushed back down, and the men start to beat him up.
No, take my money and leave me alone, will you? Look, if you want money, I told you, you can have it. Help!
Calling for help when you're being mugged in a big city park is sometimes as helpful as trying to catch hold of a windowsill in a 30-story fall. But this time, there was a miracle. A stranger has seen the attack and rushes to help.
Hey, in there, man! Here comes...
That's a nice story you have there, fella. Ooh. You need a lesson in chicken.
That took care of them. They're gone.
Oh, thanks.
Let me help you up.
Thanks, mister. Thanks a lot. I tell you, I was in real trouble.
My pleasure. Did they get your wallet?
No. I got a lot of bruises, but they didn't get a thing. Say, you're a pretty good scrapper for a
guy my age.
Well, yeah. Hey, what are you, a karate expert?
Oh, just keep myself in shape.
You sure do. Listen, can I do something for you to show you really meant thanks?
You certainly can. How about coffee?
Oh, sure, but that's nothing. What I meant was...
I know what you meant. My name's Dave Wilson.
Oh, good. I'm Larry Fielding.
Oh, come on, Larry. Let's have a cup of coffee.
Oh.
I still can't get over the way you tore into those guys.
I was a commando in World War II.
World War II?
Did you think I was in the Civil War?
No, I didn't mean that. It's just...
Well, to a young fella like you, World War II might as well have been in the last century. It was only 30-some-odd years ago, you know.
Oh, I know. After all, I was in the newspaper business.
Yeah, that's tough what you told me about losing your job. What are you going to do?
Oh, I don't know. Look around for another one. What bothers me is the way my editor let me go. No explanation. You know, we were friends. You'd think he'd at least tell me why he fired me.
Those things happen. Stop torturing yourself and begin making plans.
No, not until I get this thing straightened out in my own mind. I think I'll call my editor to home tonight and...
I've got a better idea.
Go out and get drunk, huh?
Nope. How about a trip to Paris?
Are you putting me on?
I'm serious.
Well, what are you? A scout for contestants for some kind of TV quiz show?
No, I am a man sitting on a couple of $100,000.
What?
And I need a guy just like you.
Now, look, I'm a newspaper man. Anytime a stranger starts talking about a trip to Paris and a couple of $100,000,
Walk away without even listening?
Yeah.
Even if the man just happened to maybe save you from being mugged, robbed, and beaten up?
Okay, all right, I'll listen, but believe me, that'll be it.
Fair enough. First, here's my card.
Oh, David Wilson Calridge Imports. I never heard of him.
You can call and check me out. I told you I was in World War II.
Oh, look, I'm grateful to you, but you're wasting your time.
Why don't you shut up and listen? You've probably heard about the millions of dollars in artworks and precious jewels that the GIs liberated during the last days of the war.
Liberated, sure, yeah. Well, I've heard stories.
Well, most of them are true. One that I know in particular certainly is. Did you ever hear of the Lancerre collection?
The
Lancerre came from an old French family. And the Lancerre collection is a fabulous assortment of diamonds, rubies, emeralds, and other precious stones which were seized by the Nazis when they swept through France in 1940. A pal of mine, not a commando, happened to come upon the collection when the Americans were driving the Germans back in 44.
Wait a minute. And he liberated it?
Exactly. He and a distinguished Frenchman named Henri Thiel.
What? Professor Henri Thiel? The archaeologist?
That's the man.
Oh, come on. He wouldn't,
You were saying something?
No, nothing.
You were about to say he wouldn't get involved in anything crooked, weren't you?
Yeah, something like that.
You're right, he wouldn't. But he was younger. The world was quite different then. And my GI pal was a most persuasive guy. They decided to bury the Lancerre collection. They did. They drew a map. And today, Professor Thiel is the only possessor of that map.
Uh-huh. And what happened to your nameless friend?
He's dead. Professor Thiel wants to return the jewels.
That's easy, isn't it?
Not if the professor doesn't want embarrassing questions asked about how he came by the map in the first place.
Oh, I see. What about you?
Calridge Imports is a highly respected and reputable importing firm. I want to keep it that way.
Oh, so do I, even though I've just been fired.
You haven't heard what I'm asking you to do.
Well, what?
Come with me to Paris. You're writing a story on Professor Thiel. He's good material. You'll grant me that.
Yes?
You'll interview him, naturally. During the course of that interview, he'll give you a slip of paper, which is a map showing the location of the jewels. You'll later deliver it to me. And that's all you have to do.
You, mentioned something about sitting on hundreds of thousands of dollars?
That's right. The Lancerre collection is worth that and more. I'm sitting on it. I intend to return the jewels and collect a reward. If you want to share in that, you deserve it. Mrs. Wilson, the report is positive. Fielding has agreed to go to Paris with me. He bought the story about picking up a map showing the location of the Lancerre collection. Operation successful. better be on your way, Larry. Your Jewett Fest deals in 10 minutes.
I suppose it's too late to back out, huh?
You can always back out, Larry, but I don't think you will. There's really nothing to it. Make it look like a normal interview. Take notes. The professor will give you the map. Slip it in with your notes. Bring it back to me here. I'll be waiting.
Okay.
Larry.
Yes.
Relax.
Oh, sure thing. I'll see you.
Would Monsieur mind if I join him?
I wouldn't mind at all, but I don't think I am what you're looking for.
Oh, but Monsieur is exactly what I seek. Exactly.
And just what is it you're seeking?
To warn you that you are in grave danger.
Why don't you come off it with that phony accent? If you've got something to say to me, say it.
Would Monsieur buy me a Pernod?
Sure. Garçon, Pernod, please.
Monsieur, it is very difficult for me. I do play a role, as you have guessed. And I am not here by chance. You must leave, and quickly.
Your Pernod, monsieur.
Not for me, it's for the lady.
And for you, I have a knife. Go, mademoiselle, go.
But he's going to die.
Do as I say. There'll be no problem. Simply put his head down gently on the table. So, and people will see another drunken tourist.
Your name is Larry Fielding. You're 28 years old, and you're feeling marvelous. You have just completed a fascinating interview with Professor Henry Teal. And you have the paper that you're going to hand over to your friend who's waiting at Les Deux Magots. You see him at the table where you left him. His head is down, but you're not concerned.
Dave, wake up. I saw the professor. What?
Monsieur, what has happened?
Well, I don't know. I came back to meet my friend. I guess he's passed out.
A moment, monsieur. Look, this man has been murdered.
What?
Stabbed to death. You will wait here for the police.
I will not. I'm getting out of here.
Who is there?
It is I. Open up.
What's the matter? What happened?
The other American. The young one. He got away.
You let him go?
He panicked. Ran.
Now what?
He'll probably go back to his room at the Dauphin. You'll check.
But aren't the police looking for him?
I hope so. I gave them a complete description.
And what do I say to them if they find me in his room?
A beautiful young lady like yourself. Get to him and find out where the paper is.
Promise not to scream? Right. Okay. Now, why have you picked the lock in my room?
Never mind. You have to get out of here.
Not until you tell me who you are.
If that matters, my name is Carol Johnson. I've been sent here to help you.
Oh, sure.
I know about the murder of your friend.
Wait a minute. Sent by whom?
I'll answer your questions while we're on the way.
On the way to where?
Safety.
I don't need to run. I didn't kill anybody. I'm not about to take off with a strange girl, particularly not one who's equipped with skeleton keys.
Oh, suit yourself. Goodbye.
Come in.
Monsieur de Rance-Fieding.
Yes?
Inspector Victor Roux, Sûreté.
Oh.
You will please come with me.
What for?
Suspicion of murder of another American? Monsieur David Wilson.
Inspector, listen. Why would I kill Dave? I've already told you I had an appointment to meet Dave at the cafe. He was waiting for me. Would I have walked up to a man I just killed and shake him so that he'd fall down and make a big scene?
That is your explanation. There is nothing to support it.
Well, there's nothing against it either.
There is the word of Louis Goret.
Who's he?
The waiter who attended the table at which Monsieur Wilson and you sat. The only reason that you are not, as of this moment, charged with murder is because you did return. That much the waiter's testimony supports. Only he says that Monsieur Wilson might very well have been dead shortly after you returned, and that you had time to kill him.
That's a lie.
So you say.
Oh, just check with Professor Teal. He'll tell you what time I arrived, what time I left.
We have been trying. And there has been no answer. Ah, we may have him on the telephone now. Hello? Eh? Ah? So? Very bien. Merci.
All right, well, what did he say?
That was not Professor Teal. That was his apartment. And his servant.
His servant? There was nobody there when I saw him.
Don't you mean if you saw him, monsieur?
Oh.
According to the servant, Professor Teal left for an extended holiday early this morning, and it is not known when he is expected back.
Your name is Larry Fielding. You're 32 years old, and you find yourself in prison in Paris, accused of murder. You know you've been had, and you're dealing with forces that seem beyond your control. You have a million questions, and the only man who could answer them is the man you're accused of killing. We'll be back shortly with Act Two. Many Americans, Paris means visits to the Louvre, strolls along the Seine, or fine food. But to Larry Fielding, it means the inside of a prison cell, where he sits accused of a murder he didn't commit. Fielding knows he's been caught up in something that involves more than the recovery of some stolen jewels. However, what he doesn't realize is that he's the key pawn in a deadly game, and the players are about to make some moves.
Come.
I don't think it's smart to have me come here so often.
I would not have sent for you if it were not necessary. Do you still believe that Fielding knows nothing about the operation?
I do.
Then where's the document?
Well, we don't know he ever had it, do we?
We know he visited Teal. We know that Wilson waited for him at Les Dubagots. We know he came back there. I think it is safe to assume that he was carrying the plans.
And he didn't have it on him when he was arrested.
Roger arranged to be there when Fielding was brought in and searched. He says there was nothing on him.
But he wasn't picked up right away.
Exactly. He eventually went back to his hotel room, as you know. I believe he has the paper and that he has somehow managed to hide it.
Oh.
He does us no good in prison. We shall have to arrange to have him released.
And how do we do that?
We don't. You do.
Sit down, mademoiselle. Your passport says Carol Johnson.
That's right, Inspector.
And I am told you are in my office because of the unfortunate incident in the Café Les Deux Magots.
Yes, Inspector. I just had to come here to tell you you have the wrong man.
Ah? And how do you know that?
I'm studying at the Sorbonne. I visit Les Deux Magots all the time. I was sitting right there when that man was murdered.
Formidable. You saw a man murdered and you did nothing?
Oh, at the time I didn't know it was a murder. I just thought the man had too much to drink or was ill. But the reason I know that you've arrested the wrong man is that the murdered man was dead before this young American Fields
Fielding.
Yes, well, the man was dead before Fielding ever got to the table. Fielding came and shook him. And that was when it was discovered that he was dead. I'm prepared to swear to that, Inspector.
Of course you are prepared to swear to this story that you have just told me.
Why not? It's the truth.
Of course, mademoiselle. Why would a beautiful young lady like yourself lie to an inspector of the Sûreté?
I'm not sure that I like the way you say that, Inspector. But everything will be all right if you release young Fielding.
You have told me you will swear to this statement of yours in court. Therefore, I have very little choice.
Ah, good.
But, mademoiselle, I have been the police officer for 20 years, long enough to know that witnesses who appear late with an alibi for an accused murderer often have reason.
Oh, that's ridiculous.
And I also wish to warn you, mademoiselle, that the Sûreté considers this a very much open case.
That is the business of the Sûreté. Au revoir, Inspector.
Gérard, you will follow the young lady who just left my office. And do not lose her.
Hello there.
Oh, it's you.
Want to give me a lift?
Well, I suppose I owe you something for getting me out of jail. Taxi! Taxi! There, we got one. Hop in.
Oh, thanks.
Driver, Hotel Dauphine.
Well, you look pretty good for a jailbird.
You look pretty good yourself for... Come to think of it, what are you?
An American girl in Paris trying to make a living. What are you?
An American in Paris in need of a bath, a drink, and some food.
You know, you're not bad looking.
Oh, thanks. While we seem to be exchanging compliments, can I say you're about the best looking girl I've seen since I've been here?
Thank you. Now that we like each other so much, don't you think it's time we started telling each other the truth?
Yes, I'll buy that. Écoutez-moi, opérateur, well, never, you speaking. Okay, well, look, I phoned the desk about an hour ago to get this room straightened up, and so far nothing's happened. Now, can you please just send someone up so I can sleep here tonight, huh?
Oh, while you're at it, where's our food?
Wait a minute, that's a different department.
Oh.
I'll have to call room service again.
Oh, maybe you won't have to bother.
Entrée.
Your dinner, monsieur. Madame.
Merci.
Monsieur would like me to serve?
No, no, thanks. No, I think I can handle it myself.
As monsieur wishes.
Wait a minute. Don't I know you?
I think not, monsieur.
Now, I've seen you before. I'm sure I've seen you.
Paris is a large city, monsieur. One passes people on the streets and...
The streets. The streets, that's it. You're the same guy who was at the Café Le Deux Magots.
Monsieur is mistaken.
What? Hey, wait a minute. Come back here. I want to talk to you.
Oh, now don't go chasing him down the hall.
Why not? Listen, Carol, I'm positive he's the same waiter...
You just deny it and you can't prove it.
But...
Even if you could, what do you think it means?
Well, it means... Well, I don't know. But if I get him to talk, maybe I'd find out something.
I thought you were going to clue me in.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Listen... Have you ever heard of the Lancer collection?
Of course. It's in the Louvre.
Oh.
The family of Comte de Lancer gave it to the museum after it was recovered when the Nazis fled Paris.
What?
Well, why does that shake you up so much?
Because it can't be true.
Come with me to the Louvre and I'll show it to you.
Well, that changes everything. Come on.
Where are we going?
To the American consul. Unbelievable.
What?
Simply unbelievable. Do you know what the consul told me?
Ah, I predicted it, didn't I?
Yeah, that's right. Mm-hmm. He didn't want to hear about it at all. Uh-huh. Just advised me to look up the whole thing and leave France. Incredible.
Well, not really when you understand that he doesn't know what you're talking about.
But you do.
Some of it.
Okay, take me back to the hotel.
Any reason?
I'm taking the consul's advice. If nobody's interested, I'll go back to the States.
Well, now that they've cleaned up the room so nicely, you're leaving.
Well, do you have a better idea?
More than one.
I think I'll take them one at a time.
Number one. Give me the paper Professor Teal gave you.
Well, it looks like we're finally going to level.
Where is it?
Well, first you tell me something. What is it?
I don't know.
End of conversation.
Larry, listen to me. I work for Colonel Blake, military intelligence. I was assigned to this operation.
What operation?
All I was told was that Dave Wilson, who also works for us, was coming over here with you, and that you were to get something from Professor Teal and give it to Dave.
Teal worked with you, too?
He did. But now his cover is blown, and I don't know where he is.
Who killed Wilson?
I don't know. It could have been any one of three or four foreign powers.
Then the only reason I'm alive is because somebody wants the paper.
That's right.
And if I give it to you, then there's really no reason not to kill me.
Oh, give it to me. I'll get it to Colonel Blake and we'll get you safely out of the country.
No, hold on. I got a better idea. I'll go with you to Colonel Blake and we'll give it to him together.
No, that would be too dangerous.
To whom?
Will you please trust me?
Give me a reason.
Please, where is the paper?
I burned it.
You expect me to believe that?
Why not? You expect me to believe everything you tell me?
You admit you had the paper. And somehow, between the time you ran from Les Deux Margaux, you managed to hide it in a place where experts have been unable to find it.
I told you I burned it.
And you know that's a fairy tale that no one will believe.
I don't care whether you believe it or not. Now, are you coming with me?
Where?
To talk to your Colonel Blake.
He won't see you.
Oh, I think he will. Goodbye, Carol. It was nice knowing you. I think...
You will kindly step back into your room, Monsieur Feeling.
Now, wait a minute.
Move. Let me introduce myself. I am Major Simonovich.
Oh, of the gay PAYU or the NKVD?
It does not really matter. What matters is that you and I have something to discuss.
I warned you.
Yeah, sure you did. Just like a rattlesnake does.
I do so dislike dealing with amateurs. This is strictly a business.
You mean you want to make a deal with me?
Correction. I mean you would find it wise if you wanted to make a deal with us.
For the paper?
Exactly. Where is it?
No, not so fast. Not so fast. You spoke about a deal?
You give us the paper, we give you your life.
You must really believe I'm an idiot. You people murdered Wilson. That paper is the only thing that's keeping me alive.
You have my word.
No deal.
You really believe you have a choice? Carol, call Rodzhansky. Make the usual arrangements. We will wait here.
Donnez-moi 80-36, s'il vous plaît. C'est ça. Merci.
Carol.
Yes.
Tell me something. Will I like Rodzhansky?
By this time, Larry Fielding realizes that he's been used. That he was never supposed to bring Dave Wilson a paper telling the location of the Lancer jewel collection. But his discoveries have only added to his dilemma. He was quick-witted enough to realize that his only hope was to hide the paper, because that slip of paper is his last resort. We'll be back shortly with Act Three. Paperman Larry Fielding sits waiting in his Paris hotel room, closely guarded by three members of the Russian secret police and the beautiful American girl, Carol Johnson. They are waiting for a man named Rodzhansky, who might very well be, for all Fielding knows, his executioner.
You know we mean to obtain the paper. Rodzhansky is a doctor and a chemist. He'll be here shortly. You will be put to sleep painlessly. You'll be taken from here in an ambulance to a safe place, and there you'll be injected with sodium pentothal, Fielding. You will tell us.
Look, I don't suppose you'll tell me what's so important about this piece of paper.
You have heard of the SAM-6 missiles, the surface-to-air weapons with deadly accuracy that we have developed and which were used so successfully in minor wars in Asia and the Middle East?
Yes, yes, I've heard of them.
Good. We learned that someone whose identity we still seek has invented a jamming device which would render the SAM-6 almost worthless.
Ah.
We don't believe that any such system can be invented. But we do not take chances. We have reason to believe that the piece of paper that you carried away from Professor Teal's has the information for building such a device. Ah, that will be Rodzianski. Carol, admit him.
Of course. Come in, Doctor. This is the patient.
Now, look, I really don't think this
the
is necessary.
The injection will be easier if you don't force, young man.
I don't intend to make...
Hold on! Now, his arm. Hold it still.
Good. You brought a stretcher?
Of course. There. He'll be under in a moment, so we can leave.
What is this? Gendarmes?
It has nothing to do with us. We are taking a sick man to the hospital. Put this stretcher into the ambulance. Quickly.
I must apologize, but we received a report from the hotel concierge that there was a dead man here.
Absurd, Inspector. This is Dr. Jansky. The doctor will explain this to you, Inspector.
This man became suddenly quite ill. I gave him a sedative to quiet him, and we're now taking him to the Lefebvre nursing home, as you can see by the ambulance.
And you say he is alive?
Very much so. See for yourself.
Ah, mon Dieu. I know this man.
Inspector, he must receive medical attention.
Of course, but I suggest that instead of taking him to the nursing home, he go instead to the police hospital.
Well, that's ridiculous. He's my patient.
I am afraid I must insist. This young man has most recently been released from jail, where we were holding him on a charge of murder.
If he has been released, then
released,
why...
yes. But he has not been completely cleared, so... Laurent... Begone. Take this man to the police hospital.
Did you get a report?
Yes.
And?
He'll be conscious in an hour.
And he will talk.
I'm sure of that.
He will scream to see Colonel Blake, and then your cover is blown, and the whole operation goes fooey.
What do we do?
Silence him.
But what about the papers?
We will be faulted for that, of course. But if we do not have it, neither do the Americans. Who do we have in the police hospital?
Only Leclerc.
A weakling. But he can admit Rozhansky.
Rozhansky's a doctor. He doesn't need Leclerc to admit him. He can visit his patient openly.
Thank you, my dear. I visit Fielding and he dies shortly thereafter. That idea does not appeal to me.
We have to do something.
You are both right. Carol... You will be his first visitor when he regains consciousness.
No.
Yes, Carol. Rodzianski, give her your hypodermic kit.
I don't have to do this, and I won't.
You would prefer that in my report I mention your failure with Fielding when you had some hours alone with him?
I'll go.
That is wise. Rodzianski, give her the syringe.
Here.
Quickly. The car is waiting. And Carol... If you should decide, or even think, about changing sides, it would be most unwise. You know, the French police are still most interested in the person who murdered Wilson.
You awake now, Larry?
Oh, no.
Wake up and listen to me, Larry.
What?
You've got to listen. Try to understand me.
Wait a minute. What kind of a place is this?
You're safe. It's a police hospital.
All right, but how did you get in here? Where's Rodzianski?
Look, I can understand how you feel and why you don't trust me, but the truth
really is that I am a double agent.
Oh.
Do you understand what a double agent is?
As near as I can figure out, a double agent is somebody working for two different sides.
Yes.
And neither side trusts them.
Oh.
You know, that fits you to a T. You might just be telling the truth.
I am. I really work for Colonel Blake, as I told you. The Russians know it. They think I've infiltrated the U.S. military intelligence. But in fact...
Yes, yes, I know. You've really done just the opposite.
Yes.
Worked your way into the Russian apparatus.
Exactly. Oh, Larry, how can I make you believe me?
You can't.
Listen, you were deliberately recruited. The reason you lost your job was because we got in touch with your boss. He agreed to go along. The men who jumped you were part of the setup so that Wilson could save you.
Hey, now, wait a minute. But that doesn't prove a thing. You could have learned all that working for Blake and still be with the other side and...
Oh...
Now, speaking of Wilson, how about getting him killed?
I tried to warn him, but there wasn't enough time. It was either go along with that or blow my cover and endanger the whole operation.
And when I wanted to give the plans to Blake, you objected.
Same problem. If I went with you to Blake or you went to him after we had talked, my cover was blown.
And suppose I had given you the plans. How would that have changed the situation?
We would have had a phony copy that I would have delivered to Igor and everything would have been fine. And there's still time for me to do that. If you will just believe me and tell me where the plans are.
I'd like to believe you. I really would.
Please, where are they, Larry?
Get me to Blake.
It's too dangerous. Look, you see this?
Yeah, it's a hypodermic.
It's death. Igor sent me here with this to kill you. Now, do you believe me?
Wait a minute. If you don't kill me, and I guess you don't intend to, what will Igor and his friends think? Isn't your cover blown then anyway?
Could be, but if I come back with the plans and say that I got them out of you without having to kill you, there's a chance they'll believe me.
Uh-huh.
Well?
I'm thinking. Who are you?
One of the hospital guards, monsieur.
Oh.
Mademoiselle, you have been here some time. How is the patient?
Guard.
Yes, monsieur?
Call Colonel Blake at U.S. Military Intelligence. Tell him I've got to see him right away on a matter of the utmost urgency.
Colonel Blake?
Colonel Blake.
I will inform my superior.
Now, you don't have to inform anyone. Just call him.
Yes, monsieur. The major will be disappointed. You have not followed instructions.
You are a fool. I would have had the information if you hadn't come in when you did.
I know what you were ordered to do.
What? What's this?
The moment of truth, I'm afraid, Larry.
Oh, I know how highly the Major regards you, mademoiselle. But I also know what he thinks of me. Tonight will change that. Give me that syringe.
Here, right in your arm.
Oh, you traitor. I knew.
Carol, you... You were telling me the truth.
Yes. Yes, I was. And I had to kill him. To make you see it. Where is the paper, please?
In my hotel room.
Oh, aren't you ever going to stop playing games? You know your room is searched.
Let me get dressed and I'll show you.
If it's not here, there's going to be the devil to pay.
Don't worry, it's here.
Now, I'm the one who has to be shown. Trained operatives from two special branches went over this room with everything except Geiger counters.
Okay.
Where are we going?
The bathroom.
That was searched, too.
Oh, I don't doubt it.
Oh, we went through that cabinet.
Did you now? What do you see?
Towels. Paper tissues, some of your toilet articles. We took your razor apart.
Uh-huh. And what else?
A roll of toilet tissue. unopened.
And as the French say, mademoiselle, voila.
Oh.
And now we unroll this toilet tissue and keep on rolling it, and...
Oh, my God. Where did you learn to open a package and reseal it like that?
When I was a kid, I was the best clerk in Roscoe's shipping department.
Oh, thanks. It was nice knowing you. I really mean that, Larry.
Hey, wait a minute, wait a minute. Surely I've earned the right to buy you dinner.
I'd like to.
Well, you'd better, or I'll start doing some talking.
Blackmail?
You said it.
All right. I'll meet you at Les Deux Magots at 10:30.
No way. Let's try the right bank, La Rotonde.
That's a date. I'll see you.
You better be there.
Shirts, ties. Yes, I think that's everything. Come. Oh, it's you, Rodjansky. Are you coming with me?
I am staying.
And we shall say goodbye. I do not have much time. The plane from Moscow leaves in...
I do not think you'll be taking the plane.
Are you insane? You know I've been recalled.
Not precisely.
What do you mean, not precisely?
Moscow feels you have bungled badly.
So? It's not the first time that an operation has been...
First, you were duped by the American girl. You know she was a double agent?
I know now. Did you know before she killed Leclerc?
I was not in charge at that time.
At that time?
Now there are two murders that cannot be hushed up. The French police must have a murderer to satisfy the public.
Then give them Carol. She...
I only wish that we could. They want you. You have been chosen to be the murderer. I am replacing you as the head of this section.
Ridiculous. I won't remain quiet. I have a lot I could and will say to the authorities if Moscow abandons me. Are you listening to me, Rodzansky?
I have no time to listen.
Rodzansky, wait. The hypodermic. Don't.
Oh. Igor, you should be pleased to know that your dying will serve a good cause.
Sorry, I'm late, but I...
But?
There were loose ends that had to be cleared up.
Well, I thought maybe you decided against coming.
Oh.
After all, your job here is finished.
Well, yes.
Sit down. Now that the Russians know you, there's nothing for you to do. It would be suicide to try to, huh?
Oh, well, there are other things for me.
Sure. Like getting married to a lovesick newspaper man, settling down, raising a family.
Oh. Oh, I take it I'm your first Mata Hari.
Mm-hmm. First and only.
Mm. Well, Larry, we're very different from other women. In our business, you pay dues. And they're heavy payments.
Hmm. I don't get it.
I'm talking about sitting at another cafe on the left bank. Sitting and knowing that an agent named Wilson was going to be killed. Clumsily trying to warn him and finally deciding... that his death was the way it had to be. Larry, that's a big payment.
But you can forget about it now. It wasn't your fault.
No, forget about that and forget about Leclerc.
Well, you had to...
You see, it's even hard for you to say. I had to kill him. No, Larry, I have to keep on to justify those things.
But, Carol, listen...
Bye, Larry. Thanks for the champagne.
But our dinner, I've ordered dinner. At least have dinner with me.
Oh, we both know what I have to do. If I ever change my mind, I promise I'll come running.
Larry Fielding sat in La Rotonde and watched her walk away. He knew she was walking out of his life. For a moment, he toyed with the idea of running after her and joining her world of spies. He flirted with the idea that he might even be some sort of an American James Bond. But then, the waiter brought the dinner. And to his surprise, he was hungry. And that realization made him wonder about whether or not he was truly in love. I'll be back shortly. Back in New York, Larry Fielding returned to his old job. An old friend and boss, Horace Finley, who was curious about what had happened in Paris. Finley kept pressing Larry to tell him about his Parisian adventure. Finally, Larry said, "I'll tell you, Horace. In Paris, the food was good." Our cast included William Redfield, Joan Loring, Roger DeCoven, Ian Martin, and Chris Gampel. The entire production was under the direction of Hyman Brown. And now, a preview of our next tale.
I really killed that boy, you know?
What did you say?
I killed him, Mr. Murray. I waited for him in the hallway the next day, and I grabbed him. He was a scrawny kid. It was like wringing the neck of a chicken. I do the same thing again, Mr. Murray, to the next guy who bothers my wife. They've got to learn.
You lied to me. Every stinking word you told me was a lie.
Don't be sore, Mr. Murray. I couldn't tell you the truth, could I? I mean, you wouldn't have taken the case, would you?
Yes. I would have taken the case and told you to plead guilty with cause.
No.
I wanted you to get me off. And that's what you did. Look,
I've got to go now, Mr. Murray. I just want to say thanks again.
Oh, you think it's that simple?
This is E.G. Marshall inviting you to return to our Radio Mystery Theater for another adventure in the macabre. Until next time, pleasant dreams.